Okay, sorry if I sound a little sleepy, it's very early. In order to introduce for the Matthew 24 meter series, the actual meter that's used in Matthew 24 verses 1 through 18, I have to take you back to Ephesians 1, 3 through 14, which is on screen. And I did a lot of videos on this in the Paul Meter GGS 11 channel, which will show in the video description. It's something I've done a lot of videos on. I've been working on this for 5 years. And when I did it initially, it was just like it hit me. Now, take a second and just look at that. I've got to go get some coffee. It's real important to say how I got this because a lot of people don't understand how God works, so they don't know how they can get proof of God. When you have enough Bible doctrine in you, what starts happening to you on a regular basis is the gospel verse, John 14:26, the Holy Spirit recalls to your mind. Now, if it's the Holy Spirit doing it, you'll know because you're not that smart. That's why I call myself brain out. My brains are outside me. Like every Christian, I lost my brains as soon as I got saved. And if I don't use 1 John 1:9, I don't have any brains, which is proof that you're actually saved. You know, people are always looking for, how do you prove that you're a real believer? Well, you don't have any brains. And the greatest evidence of that is the fact that Donald Trump has so many votes, because it's apostate Christians who voted for him. That means they're not using 1 John 1:9, and therefore they have absolutely no discernment whatsoever. But when you're using the verse repeatedly, daily, all you have to do is hear that guy talk, and you know he's the biggest liar since, you know, I don't know, Satan. I mean, that's kind of a hyperbole, but he's a real big liar. By the same token, if you're between sins and you're using 1 John regularly, God hits you with Bible verses, Bible principles, Bible ideas, as you learn and live on Bible. That's why I keep harping on that. God's system is use 1 John 1:9 like breathing, learn and live on Bible under your right male only teacher daily. You do that, and you get hit once you have enough Bible in you with all kinds of things. And then you can go to the Bible like we're doing here and prove it. Now, I've done, like I said, a lot of videos on this, and this is actually a song. First of all, I knew it was metered because I was in my kitchen or something. I was arguing with 1689 Baptists on YouTube, and I had to go look at the passage, and as soon as I look at it, he hits me with the idea that it's metered, and I'd been doing meter for 2 years at that time. That was back in 2010. And what you're seeing on screen is a result of that. It took me some months to write back in 2010. And it's got a cadence. You know, and I've read it before, but I'll try it again in my badly pronounced Greek. Eulogetas hoteos kai pater. Boom, boom, boom. Tu kuriou hemon Jesu Christou. And what Paul was doing here, and I knew that right away too, is he was starting at Christ's birth. And then he was making a timeline satire on church and its future history. And these are the words that, as you went through those segments of time, you were to remember, because it would be so hard to be living during that time. And what I had explained was, you know, eulogetas, hoteos, kai pater, bum, 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 that this tenning, Greek is really big on using 10 syllables, but he's using Bible meter, not, you know, typical Greek meter. And many different kinds of Greek meter. But this one is unique to Bible that started in Genesis and goes all the way through Revelation. So he's crafting a meter out of this. And what I had shown you is that here at Kuriou, that was syllable 14 by the time it ends. And he's making a sort of joke on how when that's 14 AD and how when Augustus died, he was made into a god. Okay? And then, you know, it turned out later on, I found out, that, oh, Peter is, you know, Peter has the same text in 1 Peter here. And he's interlacing a song on top of the song here, and I'm still in the process of guessing, you know, the cadence. You know, because this one seems kind of obvious. You lo geta soteos kai pater. Bam, bam, bam. Tu kuriu hemon Jesu Christu. Bam, bam, bam. Ulo holugesas hemas. En pasulogia pneumatiki. Pneumatike, an old pronunciation. En tois epuranios en Christoi. Okay? And I went through those videos. This was several years back. Just to remind you, in case you've seen them already, and if you haven't, you've got a lot of homework to do. So when you get here, you're at 47 when Caligula dies. I think it was Caligula. And then Paul launches into, this is his dateline. Hi, I'm writing when Christ should have been 56, but he was really 59 at the time. But he should have been 56, because they had the same BCAD problem we do. They had a guy named Varro who made their calendar, who screwed it up enough that they had a three-year variance in their own calendar for Varro. And so the Bible's constantly tracking that also for other reasons, because Christ was supposed to be born at a certain time, and then because of the way David died and the temple started late, Christ ends up having to be born 3 years earlier. So it's a real three-year differential, and there's actually two timelines in the Bible, one tracking the original when he should have been born, and one tracking the adjustment due to Israel being late for her appointments. Okay? So I went through all that. And that ties, of course, to the scholars saying that, you know, this was written 59 AD. I can argue it in different ways, too. I can also argue that he actually started it in 56 AD, but he let it sit until he got arrested in 58 AD. Okay? And that might be actually the better answer, because it dovetails with Matthew 24, actually, which we're going to find out here. Okay, but what I had said before with the Ephesians thing is, look, once you start to get here, see, this is past from Christ's birth, all the way up to when Paul writes, first dateline. Okay? Once he's starting here at syllable 57, en ato eprokatobolis kosmou. Okay, once he starts here, he's going future, and every one of these numbers is a what if the rapture happens here date. That's what I'd said. And, you know, this whole write-up in the PDF format of this doc, it's 150 pages long, and I'm not done with it till yet, 5 years later, because his meter is so sophisticated. But what I was never able to resolve, and I'm going to do it now, is how come Paul is doing this kind of timeline? Where's he getting it from? Because everything in the Bible has a precedence. And besides, you know, you don't really know if you're hallucinating or you got the right idea when you're looking at the meter until you can point to something and prove that it's tagging something prior. And one of the things we were able to prove that I showed 5 years ago even was that Christ at age 56 is where Mary had ended her Magnificat in her timeline. Hers was a Hanukkah timeline, starting with initial Hanukkah, ending at his age 56, which, had there been no church, would have been 40 years before the millennium. Okay, so going forward, this was like, okay, well, but there is church now. And what if the rapture occurs in 66? You know, and with hindsight, we know what 66 was. But at the time Paul's writing, it was 10 years future. What if the rapture occurs in 73, which is our 70 AD? And, of course, the temple actually went down there. So that's kind of cute about why hagios, meaning holy, as in holy of holies, is tagged at 73. Okay, and then kaiamomus, and blameless, at 77. But the big question still was, okay, Brainat, this is what you're saying the interpretation of these words are. That it's a satire on, in this particular case, Nero, who thought he was the foundation of everything. All right, well, it's plausible. But, you know, where's your smoking gun? Little did I know that when we started this thing with the Matthew 24 videos just a month or so ago, with Anonominon, and here's his own workup on it. This is the Matthew 24 workup of his in the thread in Frank Forum. Little did I know that, oh, Paul's getting it from Matthew 24. And it is so sophisticated, you could just almost not make a mistake with this. So here's my smoking gun. Okay, seriously. All right. So we're going to walk through this. This, the real important thing to understand is when Paul's writing this, that's a dateline, he's saying, hi, this is today when I write. Now, maybe he wrote it in 56 and he set it aside. Maybe, you know, what we call 59 is really 56. You know, leave all those arguments out for now. Paul is saying that Christ should have been age 56 when he writes. Okay, it's real important. That was where Mary had left her meter off. Okay, when she wrote in 5 AD Adar, composing the Magnificat, maybe when she was talking off the top of her head when she got off her donkey, I don't know. So this is where we start. This is future to when Paul writes. Okay, but Matthew 24, its dateline is 30 AD. Okay, 84 years beforehand. That's the first dateline. It's in, here's verse 1. He's got a different coloring scheme. Here's verse 1, here's verse 2, here's 84, here's our first dateline, same dateline as in Psalm 90. So you understand that, you know, it means define decree. Okay, so 30 AD is when this is, just like Matthew 1's own dateline is 30 AD. And therefore he's writing 84 years after X. Christ is speaking, actually, 2 months before he dies. And Matthew's writing it down 84 years after X. Well, the 84 years after X, what is X? Because it has to be textually and doctrinally relevant to the passage. Well, X was when Crassus, okay, defiled the temple, or robbed the temple, really. Okay? Well, he's going to be talking about that. That's a whole theme in Matthew 24. So, we know we're okay here. We know what this date is. But see, this is 30 AD versus 56 AD. So the two timelines, and this is a timeline. It's actually three of them. So the timeline in Matthew that's here marked in Matthew 24:2, very cleverly, you know, 40 years and then 44, and so therefore 84. This is starting at a different time. Point in time. So what Paul, who knew that obviously since he's keying off Matthew, he takes this text starting here and going all the way to the end of the passage, and he aligns the start of this text going forward in time from when he writes to the parallel in Matthew 24. The parallel in time to Matthew 24. And where is that? Well, it's not 84, because that's, you know, 30 AD. All right? Going forward from 30, you got another 63 years. Okay? And here's the text. All right? And he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, and the disciples came up to him, and they said, you know, oh, you know, look at all this. And what are going to be the signs of your coming in the future of the age? You know, because that's how we are. We drool over signs and wonders. Scripture doesn't interest us. Especially not in the original languages, which is so brilliant and so gorgeous and so beautiful here. You're going to die if you understand it. I'm dead serious. So this total number of syllables in Matthew 24:3, is 63 syllables. Okay? So what Paul does, this is such a killer. Since it's 63 syllables, and he's got a 56 here, in order to align himself to the Matthew passage. Okay? Because remember, he's starting in at 1 AD here. Well, what, not necessarily what we call 1 AD, but we're going to call it that for purposes of this write-up. Okay? Christ age 56. So here's what he does. Oh, this is such a killer. See, we got 63 syllables here, so he walks backward in the text, which means we know for sure the Matthew 24 text we have is the same text that Paul had. He walks all the way back 56 syllables, aka years. And what that does is that starts us right here in the Matthew text. That's where Paul is aligning Ulogetas o Theos kai Pater. He's aligning that to Epituhorus, sorry for my accent, Epituhorus ton Elio. Okay? That's where he's aligning it. It's a royal killer. A royal killer. That's not the only way he's doing it. But this is one way you could argue that he's doing it. Okay? Now, if we go with that argument, because you're going to be kind of blown away by how well it fits. If you go there, then this text in Matthew 3, which cleverly leaves out only this part, katemu dautu, okay? He's just leaving that out, and hi, my 56 syllables, me, Paul, my 56 syllables, beginning with ulogetas o Theos kai Pater, is like, as it were, laying like a piece of cloth on top of the Matthew 24 words that are highlighted in blue in the lower window. He's paralleling them. Now the question is, okay, but this is supposed to be covering from Christ's birth to his age 56, and if he's paralleling here, starting at epi the same way, then what kind of satire is he saying with the Matthew 24 words? I don't know the answer to that. Okay, I really don't. But what I'm trying to show you is that the way the first 18 verses of Matthew are lining up, Matthew 24, by Paul. Sorry. I live next to a place with a lot of sirens. Okay, if Paul is lining it up like this, and it seems he is, then what that tells us is how he used Matthew 24. It is very most definitely a rapture passage, because Paul's Ephesians is all about different what-if dates for the rapture, and you'll be able to see that, because here's the text that follows next. Remember I said you got here? Those are what-if dates for the rapture going forward in the future. And the number of syllables is 21. And the number of syllables is here, where it lines up next, 21. And this is really very clever. Okay? It's really quite very clever. So, you got from here to here as a lineup. Or no, I'm sorry, you got from here to here as a lineup. Okay, that's for the 56. Yeah, sorry, I was mapping the wrong thing. And then your 21 that's here, okay, going future in time, is right here in verse 4. Sorry. Verse 4, the 221s. So he's aligning verse 4, that's 21 syllables, with this verse 4 in Matthew 24, that's also 21 syllables. And then the previous 56, okay, starting here, going all the way, the drooling over the signs and the ends of the age, that's parallel to this. Now, your eyes might be glazing over at this point, because I know mine did the first couple of times I did it. The point I'm trying to get at here is that we have real, what do you want to call it, surgical. Because these aren't the only proofs that Paul's doing this with the text. But we have real surgical proof, A, that we have the right words in the Bible. At least with respect to these texts, and I'm beginning to think that this is how they did it all, the whole book, from Genesis to Revelation, okay? But it's going to take like 100 years before all the scholars can get together and parse out all the syllables and stuff. We can prove we have the right words that are the real words and the perfect words in the Greek, and it was the original words. Because he's layering the text the way he does. See, we're getting a live usage of how this text was used by Paul. This is the Matthew 24 text in the lower window. It's satirical, it's funny, it covers the same time period. You have to know something about the history to get the joke. But one of the things I want you to understand going in is that this is real Bible that we really have. And never mind that it's now 2015 AD. We got the right words. And not only that, but we can tell what the writers of the New Testament were doing with other New Testament books. And you know what? The scholars have never covered that. They've never covered how one New Testament scripture is tagging another New Testament scripture. I don't know why. They know how the New Testament tags the Old Testament, but they don't cover the New Testament. And there's been so much belittling of Matthew's gospel, claiming it was written in Aramaic. What a trash lie. And this proves it's a lie, because he's metering to the syllables. Okay? And the syllables are metered. Well, in Aramaic, it's not metered. Hello. So we can prove that Matthew A was the first gospel. B, no, it wasn't written in Aramaic like stupid Eusebius thought. But it was written in Greek, and oh, excuse me, it's metered the same way that the Old Testament is metered. So they're carrying on a rhetorical style. And oh, D, we got the right words. All of those scholars, all those centuries, and all those poor scribes, and you know, most of them were Catholic, tirelessly writing out word after word after word of the Bible. Yeah, you know what? God was faithful, and so were they. We got the words, and this helps prove it. Now, because I've talked so much, you're going to have to probably play this video again. I'm sorry all my stuff is always so complicated. But this is my introduction to Matthew 24, verses 1 through 18, because the total number of syllables there is, drum roll please, 560. And the big, you know, shocker to me is that Paul is layering these words in Ephesians on Matthew 24, starting right here at epi, going to the end of verse 3, in order to get everybody on the same page, and then starting at Matthew 24, verse 4, where it says, Kai apokretis ho Jesus aipnautois vlepete me tis humas planeste. You can't read it too well, I don't have my glasses on. That he's aligning his 21 syllables here in this period of time, that we know what it is, with Matthew, which tells us that the Matthew timeline and what Paul is doing are at least in part covering the same year, so we should find more satire. Now, if you haven't gone to sleep already, you ought to be pretty much in a state of shock right now. I know I am, and I need a break. Peace out for now.